Penguin Random House Audio presents Stalin, the Court of the Red Tsar, by Simon Sebag Montefiore. Read for you by Jonathan Aris. Prologue. The Holiday Dinner. 8th of November, 1932. At around 7 p.m. on the 8th of November, 1932, Nadia Aleluyeva Stalin, aged 31, the oval-faced and brown-eyed wife of the Bolshevik General Secretary, was dressing for the raucous annual party to celebrate the 15th anniversary of the revolution. Puritanical, earnest but fragile, Nadia prided herself on her Bolshevik modesty, wearing the dullest and most shapeless dresses, draped in plain shawls with square-necked blouses and no makeup. But tonight, she was making a special effort. In the Stalin's gloomy apartment in the two-story 17th-century Potiechny Palace, she twirled for her sister Anna in a long, unusually fashionable black dress with red roses embroidered around it, imported from Berlin. For once, she had indulged in a stylish hairdo instead of her usual severe bun. She playfully placed a scarlet tea rose in her black hair. The party, attended by all the Bolshevik magnates, such as Premier Molotov and his slim, clever, and flirtatious wife Polina, Nadia's best friend, was held annually by the defense commissar, Voroshilov. He lived in the long, thin Horse Guards building just 5 steps across a little lane from the Potiechny. In the tiny, intimate world of the Bolshevik elite, those simple, cheerful soirees usually ended with the potentates and their women dancing Cossack jigs and singing Georgian laments. But that night, the party did not end as usual. Simultaneously, a few hundred yards to the east, closer to Lenin's mausoleum and Red Square, in his office on the second floor of the triangular 18th century Yellow Palace, Joseph Stalin, the General Secretary of the Bolshevik Party, and the Vojd, the leader of the Soviet Union, now 53, 22 years Nadia's senior and the father of her 2 children, was meeting his favored secret policeman. Yenrich Yagoda, deputy chairman of the GPU, a ferret-faced Jewish jeweler's son from Nizhny Novgorod with a Hitlerish moustache and a taste for orchids, German pornography, and literary friendships, informed Stalin of new plots against him in the party and more turbulence in the countryside. Stalin, assisted by Molotov, 42, and his economics chief, Valerian Kuibyshev, 45, who looked like a mad poet with wild hair, an enthusiasm for drink, women, and, appropriately, writing poetry, ordered the arrest of those who opposed them. The stress of those months was stifling, as Stalin feared losing the Ukraine itself, which in parts had descended into a dystopia of starvation and disorder. When Yagoda left at 7:05 p.m., the others stayed, talking about their war to break the back of the peasantry, whatever the cost to the millions starving in history's greatest man-made famine. They were determined to use the grain to finance their gargantuan push to make Russia a modern industrial power. But that night, the tragedy would be closer to home. Stalin was to face a personal crisis that was the most wounding and mysterious of his career. He would replay it over and over again for the rest of his days. At 8:05 p.m., Stalin, accompanied by the others, ambled down the steps towards the party, through the snowy alleyways and squares of that red-walled medieval fortress, dressed in his party tunic, baggy old trousers, soft leather boots, old army greatcoat, and his wolf shapka with earmuffs. His left arm was slightly shorter than the other, but much less noticeable than it became in old age, and he was usually smoking a cigarette or puffing on his pipe. The head and the thick, low hair, still black but with specks of the first grey, radiated the graceful strength of the mountain men of the Caucasus. His almost oriental, feline eyes were honey-coloured, but flashed a lupine yellow in anger. Children found his moustache prickly and his smell of tobacco acrid, but as Molotov and his female admirers recalled, Stalin was still attractive to women, with whom he flirted shyly and clumsily. This small, sturdy figure, 5 feet 6 inches tall, who walked ponderously yet briskly with a rough pigeon-toed gait, which was studiously aped by Bolshoi actors when they were playing Tsars, chatting softly to Molotov in his heavy Georgian accent, was only protected by one or two guards. The magnate strolled around Moscow with hardly any security. Even the suspicious Stalin, who was already hated in the countryside, walked home from his old square office with just one bodyguard. Molotov and Stalin were walking home one night in a snowstorm with no bodyguards through the Manege Square when they were approached by a beggar. Stalin gave him 10 rubles, and the disappointed tramp shouted, "You damned bourgeois!" "Who can understand our people?" mused Stalin. Despite assassinations of Soviet officials, including an attempt on Lenin in 1918, things were remarkably relaxed until the June 1927 assassination of the Soviet ambassador to Poland, when there was a slight tightening of security. In 1930, the Politburo passed a decree to ban Comrade Stalin from walking around town on foot. Yet he continued his strolling for a few more years. This was a golden age which, in just a few hours, was to end in death, if not murder. Stalin was already famous for his Sphinxian inscrutability and phlegmatic modesty, represented by the pipe he ostentatiously puffed like a peasant elder. Far from being the colorless bureaucratic mediocrity disdained by Trotsky, the real Stalin was an energetic and vainglorious melodramatist who was exceptional in every way. Beneath the eerie calm of these unfathomable waters were deadly whirlpools of ambition, anger, and unhappiness. Capable both of moving with controlled gradualism and of reckless gambles, he seemed enclosed inside a cold suit of steely armor, but his antennae were intensely sensitive, and his fiery Georgian temper was so uncontrollable that he had almost ruined his career by unleashing it against Lenin's wife. He was a mercurial neurotic, with the tense, seething temperament of a highly strung actor who revels in his own drama, what his ultimate successor Nikita Khrushchev called a litsidier, a man of many faces. Lazar Kaganovich, one of his closest comrades for over 30 years, who was also on his way to the dinner, left the best description of this unique character. He was a different man at different times. I knew no less than 5 or 6 Stalins. However, the opening of his archives and many newly available sources illuminate him more than ever before. It's no longer enough to describe him as an enigma. We now know how he talked, constantly about himself, often with revealing honesty, how he wrote notes and letters, what he ate, sang, and read. Placed in the context of the vociferous Bolshevik leadership, a unique environment, he becomes a real person. The man inside was a super-intelligent and gifted politician for whom his own historic role was paramount, a nervy intellectual who manically read history and literature, a fidgety hypochondriac suffering from chronic tonsillitis, psoriasis, rheumatic aches from his deformed arm and the iciness of his Siberian exile. Garrulous, sociable, and a fine singer, this lonely and unhappy man ruined every love relationship and friendship in his life by sacrificing happiness to political necessity and cannibalistic paranoia. Damaged by his childhood and abnormally cold in temperament, he tried to be a loving father and husband, yet poisoned every emotional well. This nostalgic lover of roses and mimosas, who believed the solution to every human problem was death, and who was obsessed with executions. This atheist owed everything to priests and saw the world in terms of sin and repentance, yet he was a convinced Marxist fanatic from his youth. His fanaticism was semi-Islamic, his messianic egotism boundless. He assumed the imperial mission of the Russians, yet remained very much a Georgian, bringing the vendettas of his forefathers northwards to Muscovy. Most public men share the Caesarian habit of detaching themselves to admire their own figures on the world stage, But Stalin's detachment was a degree greater. His adopted son, Artyom Sergeyev, remembers Stalin shouting at his son Vasily for exploiting his father's name. "But I'm a Stalin too," said Vasily.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.